Okay, welcome to this tutorial session of the course Engineering Thermodynamics. In this particular session, first we will have a discussion on problems related to diesel and refrigeration cycles, and then I'll take up your specific queries. Okay. So let me go to next slide. This is problem one. So this problem is of an ideal diesel cycle. Okay. So in this question, we have an ideal diesel cycle, and this ideal diesel cycle has compression ratio of 20. Okay, so compression ratio R, which is nothing but ratio of total volume till TDC divided by clearance volume V1 by V2, that is given as 20, and it uses air as the working fluid. The state of air at beginning of the compression process is 95 kilopascals and 20 degrees Celsius, and the maximum temperature in the cycle should not exceed 2200 Kelvin. We have to determine the thermal efficiency, mean effective pressure, when we are assuming that specific heats for air at room temperature are actually constant, and we are considering these only for our entire cycle. Okay, so what we will be having for this situation, if I draw a PV diagram. So PV diagram for an ideal diesel cycle is something like this. Okay, so this is the PV diagram for an ideal diesel cycle. Now this is my point number one, this is point number two, this is three, and this is four. So now if you see the given parameters, first part is given that compression ratio, which is nothing but ratio of volume V1 divided by V2. This compression ratio is given as 20. Okay, then second parameter is given that our pressure at the inlet of the compression. So P1 is 95 kilopascals. Another condition is given that temperature at the inlet is nothing but 20 degrees Celsius. So it will be equal to 293 Kelvin. Okay, then another condition is given that highest temperature in our cycle should not exceed a value of 2200 Kelvin. So we know in our cycle the highest temperature will be nothing but temperature at the exit of the combustion process. So combustion process over here is ending at point number 3. So T3 temperature I am writing as nothing but equal to 2200 Kelvin. Okay. Now what we have to do, we have to determine two parameters. First, we have to determine the efficiency of the cycle, and second, we have to calculate its mean effective pressure. Okay, so now we know if we have to determine the efficiency, what we require, efficiency of the diesel cycle is nothing but 1 minus 1 divided by R to power gamma minus 1 into 1 by gamma multiplied by RC power gamma minus 1 divided by RC minus 1. Okay, so first I have to determine value of RC. R is given over here. We know that RC is nothing but equal to V3 divided by V2. So cutoff ratio is defined as V3 by V2. So this is what I have to calculate. Okay, now we have already seen that if I take process number 2 to 3, if I take process number 2 to 3, for process 2 to 3, my pressure will be constant, and I'll be having V2 divided by T2 equal to V3 divided by T3. So from here I can simply say that my V3 by V2, which is nothing but our R, is equal to T3 divided by T2. So here you can see we know the value of temperature T3. It is given to us. We know the value of temperature T1. Now 1 to 2 process is nothing but, 1 to 2 process is actually our isentropic compression process. So for this process I can calculate, I can apply the adiabatic equation, and I can calculate the value of temperature. Okay. So for process 1 to 2 I can say that T1 V1 gamma minus 1 will be equal to T2 V2 gamma minus 1. And over here R, which is compression ratio 20, that will be nothing but equal to V1 by V2. So now I know the value of ratio V1 by V2. I know for air gamma equal to 1.4, T1 is given. So I will be able to calculate from here value of temperature T2 as nothing but equal to 971 Kelvin. Okay, so value of T2 is now known to me. Once the value of T2 is known to me, what I can do, I can calculate. Once the value of T2 is known to me, I can calculate my next value, which is our cutoff ratio. So cutoff ratio is nothing but equal to T3 by T2. Okay, and T3 we are already having, T2 just now I have calculated. So if you calculate, you will be finding cutoff ratio as 2.26. Okay, now we are having cutoff ratio, compression ratio is already given in the question. So if I substitute these two in the formulation of efficiency, I'll be finally finding value of efficiency as nothing but 63.5%. So this is how our first part is done. Now second part, we have to find out the mean effective pressure. So we know the formulation of mean effective pressure is nothing but net amount of work done divided by V1 minus V2, because we consider that whatever the net work we are getting, if we are displacing piston from top dead center to bottom dead center, during that displacement, if we are having some constant value of effective pressure, that we call as nothing but mean effective pressure. Okay, so for finding mean effective pressure, I have to calculate net amount of work done, and this is nothing but a thermodynamic cycle. So for thermodynamic cyclic process, we know that net amount of work done will be equal to net amount of heat transfer, and net amount of heat transfer will be nothing but equal to Q in minus Q out. Okay, so Q in, we are having heat addition at 2 to 3 process. So that will be Cp times T3 minus T2, and Q out will be Cv times T4 minus T1. Okay, so this is my Q out over here. Now, if you see over here, what we are having, we have to once again apply the reversible adiabatic equation, T3 V3 gamma minus 1, and this will be equal to T4 V4 gamma minus 1, and using this equation we can calculate the value of T4. Once T4 is calculated, T1 is already given and all other parameters are known, so I will be able to calculate the net amount of work done as nothing but equal to 784.32 kilojoule per kg, because every parameter we are writing on per kg basis. Okay, now what we have to do, now we have to calculate the mean effective pressure. So we know the formulation of mean effective pressure is nothing but W net divided by V1 minus V2. Okay, so W net is there on the per kg basis, so this volume also I will be writing on per kg basis, so it will be becoming small v, specific volume over here. Okay, now we know we are having air as our working substance, and air is behaving as ideal gas. So for air, I can write P1 V1 equal to R into T1. So I know the value of P1, I know the value of T1, I know value of R. From here, I will be able to calculate the value of specific volume, V1 as equal to 0.8851 meter cube per kg. Okay, so now I know the value of volume at 0.1, and I know that compression ratio is V1 by V2. Okay, because mass is constant, medium, we are having same medium inside our piston cylinder arrangement based on the ideal gas assumption, so that medium is not changing, amount is not changing. So that's why I can say that my specific volume V2 will be specific volume at 0.1 divided by R. Okay, so from here I can calculate, or I can relate the value of V2 in terms of V1 and R. So now I have all the parameters. So if I substitute over here, finally I will be finding value of mean effective pressure as 933 kilopascals. Okay, so this will be the final answer for problem number 1. Okay, now let me take one more problem. So we are having a second question. So in this question, if you read the problem statement, we are having air standard diesel cycle. So here also compression ratio is given as 16, and at the beginning Of the isentropic compression process, we have temperature as 15 degree Celsius and pressure as 0.1 megapascals. Okay, and now we are adding the heat until the temperature at the end of constant pressure process is becoming 1480. So our maximum temperature is limited to 1480 degree Celsius. We have to calculate cutoff ratio, we have to calculate heat supplied, and we have to calculate cycle efficiency, and we have to determine the mean effective pressure. So this problem actually is exactly similar to that of the one which I have discussed earlier. Okay, so what I will be doing here also, I will show you the solution. In the meantime, you also practice by your own, and then try to compare your answers with mine. Okay, so you can practice by your own, and I will be also doing over here, so finally you can match the answers. So if I write over here, so initial pressure P1 is given as 0.1 megapascals. So 0.1 megapascal is equal to 100 kilopascals. Okay, then we have initial temperature given as 15 degree Celsius, which will be equal to 288 Kelvin if I convert it into Kelvin. Okay, then the maximum temperature at the end of the combustion is given as 1480 degree Celsius, and if we convert it into Kelvin, it will be 1753 Kelvin. Okay, now what we have to do, one more parameter is given. We are having R as V1 by V2, which is given as 16. Okay, so now if we are knowing the value of pressure and we are knowing the value of temperature at the inlet to the compression process, so I can apply over here ideal gas equation P1 V1 equal to RT1. So from here I will be able to calculate value of specific volume V1 as 0.827 meter cube per kg. So this is how I can calculate the value of specific volume. Okay, now what I have to do, I have to determine the first part is I have to calculate amount of heat added, and we have to determine cutoff ratio also. Okay, so for obtaining the amount of heat, Q in will be equal to Cp times Q in will be equal to Cp times T3 minus T2. So T3 I know, I have to calculate T2. So how I will be calculating T2? For process number 1 to 2, I will be applying equation T1 V1 gamma minus 1 equal to T2 V2 gamma minus 1. From here, I will be calculating the value of temperature T2 as 873 Kelvin. So if I substitute this 873 Kelvin, I will be finding Q in as 883.16 kilojoule per kg. Okay. Now next part, I have to determine cutoff ratio. So cutoff ratio, in the earlier problem we have seen cutoff ratio as equal to T3 divided by T2. So if you substitute the values, you will be finding cutoff ratio as 2.01. Okay, then we are having the thermal efficiency of the cycle. So thermal efficiency of the cycle, we are already having the formulation in terms of compression ratio, cutoff ratio. So if I substitute all these over here, I will be finding thermal efficiency as 61.33%. Okay, and net amount of work done, then I have to calculate. So net amount of work done, once again I can write Q in minus Q out. So if I have to do Q in minus Q out, I have to first calculate the amount of Q output. Okay, so Q output will be Cv times T4 minus T1. So T4 I need to determine. So what I will be doing during process 3 to 4, I will write T3 V3 gamma minus 1 equal to T4 V4 gamma minus 1. Okay, and V3 I can find by using, how to find out V3? So I know compression ratio and I know value. So from here I will be able to calculate V2. Now I know cutoff ratio, and I know if I calculate V2 from here, I will be able to calculate V3. So once V3 we are having, if I substitute in this equation, finally I will be finding the value of T4. And if I substitute the value of T4 in my expression of out heat transfer, that will be equal to 341.52 kilojoule per kg. Okay. So this, once we have estimated, we will be having net work as equal to 541.64 kilojoule per kg. Okay. Now already I told you about the last part, mean effective pressure, that will be equal to W net divided by V1 minus V2. Okay. So V1 we are having, V2 we have just now calculated. So mean effective pressure will be coming as 698.61 kilopascals. Okay. So this is the second problem related to diesel cycle. So it is almost similar to that what we have discussed as problem number one. Okay. Now let me take up one more question. So this particular question is actually from refrigeration cycle. So we are having one refrigerator, and this refrigerator uses refrigerant R134a. So we are having some working medium in the inside the refrigerant cycle. So for example, in refrigeration cycle we have some evaporator, compressor, condenser. So the working medium which passes through each and every component, that we call as our refrigerant, and we are having wide range of refrigerants available depending upon their characteristics and the requirement for particular applications. So the problem over here is related to refrigerant 134A as the working medium. Okay. And this operates on ideal vapor compression cycle. So this particular device is actually operating on an ideal vapor compression refrigeration system, VCRS system, between 0.12 and 0.7 megapascals pressure. So it means 0.12 is our low pressure, so it will be evaporator pressure, and 0.7 will be our high pressure, which is condenser pressure. Okay. Now the mass flow rate of the refrigerant which is passing through different components, that is 0.05 kg per second. We have to show the cycle on a TS diagram, and we have to determine the rate of heat removal from the refrigerated space. Okay, so refrigerated space, actually our evaporator is located in the refrigerated space. So we have to find out that how much heat evaporator has taken from the refrigerated space. Okay, and we have to also determine the power input to the compressor. And secondly, we have to determine the rate of heat rejection to the environment. So rate of heat rejection takes place, heat rejection takes place in condenser. So we have to determine amount of heat which refrigerant has given to surroundings, and then we have to also determine the coefficient of performance. Okay. So let me first show this ideal vapor compression refrigeration system on different property diagrams. Okay. So if I plot this vapor compression refrigeration system on my TS diagram, it will be looking something like this. I will be having two pressure lines, one at pressure of, I have condenser pressure of evaporator pressure of nothing but 0.12 megapascals, and another pressure line I'll be having with a value of 0.7 megapascals. Okay, now if I consider that my cycle is ideal, for ideal cycle compression should start at saturated vapor state. So this 1-2-2 is my compression process for the ideal cycle. Then I will be having cooling, and this point number 3 should be at saturated liquid state for the ideal cycle. So this is my point number 3, and then I will be having expansion in throttling device. So then I will be finding this as my point number 4, and 4-1 will be the process inside the evaporator. Okay. So now if you see, we know the mass flow rate. So mass flow rate is given as 0.05 kg per second. So now what we have to do, if we have to answer this question, we have to determine the values of thermodynamic properties at different terminal points. Okay. So one by one, let me take up different points. So if I first talk about point number one, we are having the value of pressure. So pressure at point number one is 0.12 megapascals. And if you see the physical state of point number one, it is saturated vapor state. Okay, so we are also knowing the physical state of point number one as saturated vapor state. So that's why I can go to R134a property table. So I have to use the property table of R134a refrigerant and I have to go to its saturation table now. Okay, and in the saturation table, I have to locate pressure of 0.12 megapascals. And at 0.12 megapascal, I have to determine the value of saturated vapor enthalpy. So H1 will be nothing but Hg at 0.12 megapascals. That will be my H1, and this is equal to 233.86 kilojoule per kg. Okay. Then we have similarly, I can determine the value of specific entropy S1. So S1 will be equal to Sg at 0.12 megapascals, and that is equal to 0.9354 kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Okay, so this is how I can calculate the value of H1 and S1. Now the process number 1 to 2 is isentropic process. So process number 1 to 2 is isentropic compression. So for this process, I can say that S1 will be equal to S2, okay, because process is isentropic. If S1 is equal to S2, in that case, my what will be happening? My S2 value will be once again equal to 0.9354 kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Okay. So now if you see at point number 2, I know the value of pressure as 0.7 megapascal and I know the value of entropy as 0.99354. Okay. So first I have to verify whether my state 2 is in the superheated regime or in the saturated state. So for that, what I can do, I can go to 0.7 megapascals. Okay. I will go to 0.7 megapascals and at 0.7 megapascals, I will calculate value of Sg. Okay. So at 0.7 megapascals, I'll be calculating the value of Sg. And if my entropy of 0.2 is greater than Sg, it means my state is nothing but superheated. Okay. So this is one important thing we are doing over here. We are finding whether state 2 is in the saturated state or it is in the superheated state. So for that, what I have done, I was knowing the value of pressure at 0.2 as 0.7 megapascal. So corresponding to 0.7 megapascal, I have checked the entropy of gas. And I found that my actual value of entropy at 0.2, which I have obtained from isentropic compression process, that is more in comparison to entropy of the gaseous phase. So that's why I have superheated state. So now I have to refer to the superheated property diagram. And if I go to superheated property diagram, I know now two parameters, entropy and pressure. So I can determine another parameter, enthalpy. Okay. So any other parameter I can determine now. So if I calculate like this, I'll be finding value of enthalpy H2 as 270.22 kilojoule per kg. So this I will be obtaining from superheated table for R134a. Okay. Then I have a point number 3. So point number 3, I know pressure 0.7 megapascal and I know that state of the substance is saturated liquid. So H3 will be equal to HF at 0.7 megapascal and that is equal to 86.78 kilojoule per kg. Okay. Now I have to calculate H4. So H4 will be equal to H3 because we are having expansion, isenthalpic expansion process over here. Okay. So now I can easily determine all other parameters what we have to determine. So first we have to determine the amount of heat taken from the refrigerated space. So that will be equal to Q dot E evaporator heat. So evaporator heat will be mass flow rate of the refrigerant into, if you see in this diagram, previous diagram, our evaporator is located between point number 4 to 1. So I'll be having M dot into H1 minus H4. Okay. So if I calculate this, it is equal to 7.354 kilowatt. Okay. then I have to calculate compressor work. So, or I can calculate even amount of heat rejected also. So if amount of heat rejected I have to calculate in the condenser, Q dot H will be M dot into H2 minus H3. So this will be equal to 9.172 kilowatt. Then I have to calculate compressor work. So compressor work I can simply write Q dot H minus Q dot E, or I can also write it as M dot into H2 minus H1. So this will be equal to 1.818 kilowatt. And now if I have to calculate the COP, COP will be equal to Q dot E divided by W dot C. So this will be equal to 4.045. Okay. So this is how we can solve the problems related to refrigeration cycle. Now one important point I would like to tell you over here. When we will be referring to the property tables for different refrigerants from different sources, you may find that absolute value of the property is actually coming different. Okay, because the different sources of refrigeration tables are using different reference state for each and for each refrigerant. Okay, so that's why you may find that absolute value of the properties like enthalpy, entropy, specific volume, etc. will not be matching, okay, from different sources of refrigeration table. Because in case of a steam table, we have seen that we are having some fixed reference state, and each and every source is following that fixed reference state. So that's why we are getting same value of the absolute properties at each and every point, okay, from different sources, okay. But if we go to the refrigeration table, so different sources use different reference points for determining the properties of the refrigerants. So that's why you may find from different sources that the absolute value of the property is actually not matching. But if you are consistently using a single source, you will be finding that whatever the difference of enthalpy between two points you are getting, that will be same. That will be same for each and every property table, irrespective of its reference state. Okay, so difference will always remain same. So that's why don't get confused yourself with the absolute value of the property, particularly while you are obtaining for the refrigerants, because we are having number of property diagrams available for refrigerants in different textbooks or in different sources also, and each of the source use their own reference states. Okay, so now I'll stop at this point.